President Hill, Dean Chenette, members of the Vassar community, friends, parents, children, neighbors, and guests. As director of the Vassar Women's Studies Program, it is my very great honor and pleasure to welcome you here tonight. Gloria Steinem, a writer, lecturer, and media spokesperson for over 40 years. The list of organizations that she has founded or helped to found speaks to the extraordinary reach of her involvement with issues of equality and human rights. The Women's Action Alliance, the National Women's Political Caucus, the Women's Media Center, Voters for Choice, Choice USA, the Ms. Foundation, Ms. Magazine, which she co-founded in 1972, not only changed the representation of women in the media, but also gave them a new title. The titles of her own books, Outrageous Acts and Everyday Rebellions, Revolution from Within, Moving Beyond Words, are a kind of shorthand of her own spirit, her strength, commitment, and courage, her realism about where we are, and her hope for where we may soon be. It's an awe-inspiring biography. But no list of accomplishments can really bring home what Gloria Steinem has meant to three generations of women and men. So tonight, I'd like to share with you just a few stories of what I call Gloria Steinem moments in the lives of my women's studies colleagues. One remembered buying Ms. magazine at the Amazon bookstore, reading Ms. and being part of a vibrant feminist community. Another remembers that she saw Gloria speak at the University of Virginia in 1987 or 88 with my mother. I loved how Steinem said that women should feel free to bring small children, even crying babies, to political events and talks. The presence of that mother, who came all the way from Virginia to be here tonight, and of so many other mothers and daughters in the audience, makes my point better than any words. Vassar has an institutional Gloria Steinem moment, too. It came in May 1970, when Gloria was invited by the senior class to deliver the commencement address. She spoke here only a few weeks after she testified before Congress in support of the Equal Rights Amendment, and also only a few weeks after the shootings at Kent State. As you might expect, it was a most unconventional graduation speech. It's available on the internet. I urge you all to read it. But tonight, I have time to only quote one sentence. The first problem for all of us, men and women, is not to learn, but to unlearn. That's one of the best definitions of education I've ever heard. I wish I had been in the audience to hear it that day. It would have saved me a lot of time. Thanks, Gloria, for the 40 years of unlearning you have helped us all to do. But we are at a different moment in Vassar's history, and it belongs to a new generation. This is their Gloria Steinem moment. So I would like to call now on two current members of Vassar's Feminist Alliance, Farron Tang and Lauren Mulligan, to introduce Ms. Steinem to you now. All that remains for me to say is, welcome back.
It is a real honor to have Gloria Steinem here speaking to the Vassar community. As an icon of the feminist movement and lifelong activist of the cause, she represents the perseverance and resilience that the feminist community at Vassar hopes to embody. Her practice of living her principles and fighting for the liberation of a diversity of women is an inspiration to students here who hope to effect concrete change in the world. Gloria Steinem represents lived and applied feminism and continues to reach to the younger generation to speak and to listen. We are grateful for her commitment to sharing with us the wisdom of the women who came before us, while allowing for our own interpretation of feminism and its application in our own realities today.
We, as young feminists, are occupied with the everyday business of smashing the patriarchy. It's not always as glamorous as it sounds. We are political activists and victim advocates and community builders. Our practice means the continual work of answering hotlines, of organizing events and protests and coordinated responses, of articulating our ideas inside the classroom and out. It means late night meeting after late night meeting, scrambling to get an editorial written before the paper goes to print. It means our frustration when we hear about the latest piece of anti-woman legislation or hear the latest offhand sexist joke. We can get bogged down in the day-to-day work of living as feminist activists. But when we stop moving long enough to think, we know that we are not alone. We are part of a legacy. The work that we do now stands on the foundation of the work of all the incredible women who have come before us. And even when it feels like we're stuck, we are working to build what I hope our daughters will someday take for granted. We come from somewhere, and that can only mean that we are going somewhere. With us tonight, we have an icon of our legacy, a name many of us identified with feminism long before we could articulate what feminism was or why it was important, a name that stood for what we needed long before we knew we needed it. It is our absolute pleasure to welcome Gloria Steinem.
Well, are we going to have a great time tonight, or what? I am going to talk for a while, but for a short while, because I feel the energy in this room. I know very well this is an organizing meeting. I have no idea what will come out of this, but I've been introduced by the future, and you are it. Obviously, Vassar is part of your life, or most of your lives, but as you've already heard, Vassar was part of my life, because in 1970, I did come here to do the graduation address, thanks to a troublemaking senior named Ann Northrup, we should pay tribute, who became a founder of ACT UP, thanks to the anti-Vietnam War movement of the era, I think I was a protest speaker. That is, I was chosen as a protest. and the reason this is so significant in my life is that I had never in my life before given a speech like that. I thought I was going to die, just plain die. I don't know your symptoms of nervousness, but mine are that I lose all my saliva and each tooth gets like a little Angora sweater on it, and you're not sure that you can get to the end of a sentence, you know? Isn't it wonderful to have a signer who does Angora sweaters on them? So it really was a true landmark experience for me. And I remember saying in that speech that I wanted to say thank you to Vassar because they had made it possible, because it was an anti-war graduation and with peace symbols on their hats and so on, that for me to not say as a graduation speaker to talk about entering the world, but to thank Vassar for making a campus part of the world. And I think that is the tradition that has continued and enlarged. I really try to answer the question, you know, people ask me things like, where is the women's movement? Where is it going? Where has it been? You know, it's sort of like describe the universe and give two examples. And of course, nobody can do that. But I do think that kind of question is useful for at least one reason, and that is to understand the length of the change we are talking about, especially now when the form that opposition takes, well, there are two forms. One is the backlash, as we see from Mr. Romney the backlash, right? Against the progress of all the social justice movements and the environmental movement and so on. And the other, from the more enlightened folks, is to say, well, it used to be necessary, but it's not anymore. So perhaps we should remember that it took more than a century to gain a legal identity as human beings and citizens for women of all races and men of color in this country, a century. So if it took a century to gain a legal identity, it is not so surprising that it may take almost that long to gain legal and social equality. And that's why we need to be in this for the long haul. It's why we need to understand that, as the Cherokee say, it takes four generations to heal one act of violence. Change does not so much proceed, in my experience, in a straight line as it does in a spiral, in which the cycles of injustice don't suddenly stop, but they get smaller and smaller and smaller until they disappear. It is clearly part of the opposition to say that this change is over. So I thought I would give a few examples of where we've been and where we're going. I think where we've been has been naming. You know, in order to become visible, in order to be visible, is a revolution in itself. It is hugely important to be able to say black power, to be able to say lesbian, gay, transsexual. It is hugely important to be able to name ourselves. We have the right to name ourselves. It is a revolutionary act in itself. And we are really still in that process. Because there are many ways that we have not yet become visible. I'm not for a moment suggesting that this phase is over. But I think what is coming into the cycles now is the ability to say, because we are visible, at least to each other, we are visible, the ability to point out the ways in which we are interconnected. It's as if we had natural stages, natural or not, of dependence as children, independence as young people, interdependence as we grow wiser. And I think that happens with social justice movements too. So perhaps we can begin to see the ways that we are, in fact, not ranked but linked. You know, people, reporters also sometimes say to me, aren't you interested in anything but the women's movement? So for 40 years, I've been saying, name one thing. And in 40 years, I have never been able to come up with one single thing that would not be transformed if you included everybody. If you had the radical idea of looking at the world as if everyone mattered, if you transformed the paradigm from a hierarchy to a circle. So I think that at the same time that we have many more things to become visible, what's an example of what hasn't become visible? Well, I think that we have really shown the difference between sex and violence. That is, we understand that rape is not sex, it's violence. And this is a huge, huge change, because when we started, rape was perceived as being natural and normal and actually the fault of the person who was dressed or inviting. Or in fact, women were supposed to be naturally masochistic. How many people can remember that? Too many of us, right? But we still have not really explained or brought into the light the difference between, say, pornography and erotica. The words are useful because porne means female slavery. It means writing about female slavery or men playing the role of female slaves. And erotica comes from eros and has an idea of mutuality, free choice, mutual pleasure. It's crucial because, especially now, as when I'm on so many campuses and I see the degree to which pornography has invaded the computers and the dormitories and the lives of so many people and distorted the feeling of men as well as women about what sexuality really is. I noticed last week in the New York Times there was a wonderfully radical woman who is putting real sexual encounters online as opposed to pornography because they're so different, right? I thought, not a bad idea, you know. So they're playful, they're mutual, they're pleasurable, they're, you know, it's really quite different. And we have pornography giving us images, especially of women, that are quite false. I mean, that they, women are supposed to look like 10-year-olds and have no body hair of any kind. And so, in fact, I was on a campus where a young man said to me he was shocked to discover that women have pubic hair. I said, really? Don't you have pubic hair? He said, yes, but I never knew. He said, I've only looked at pornography. I had no idea. All right. You can't make this stuff up, okay. So there are many, many examples of ways in which we still have to make reality visible and the realities of all of us as both unique individuals and members of the community and the human community. But I thought I would take a few that are driving me crazy and see if they're driving you crazy too. How about the division between economic issues and women's issues? Now, you could take that from many points of view. Actually, it happens that the ability to decide for ourselves when and whether to have children is the single biggest determinant of the economic status of women, also the biggest determinant of our educational status and of our health status and of how long we live. I mean, this is huge, right? I would say this is an underpinning of all the issues. But even if you think in the way that the issues of, say, this election are being phrased, the truth is that equal pay for women in this country would be the single biggest and most effective economic stimulus there could possibly be. Someone, not me, figured it out and said that equal pay alone would put $200 billion more dollars into the economy every year. It would mean that the average white woman received about $150 more a week. The average woman of color somewhere between $250 and $350 a week. That's huge. And that money would be exactly where it's most likely to be spent, because those are the people who are most likely to be in need, to have children in need, to put it back in the economy and to create jobs. I mean, that is so much more a vital economic issue than this trickle-down stuff, that if you're nice to the rich, they'll be nice to you. I don't think so. That has not been... So I hope that when we... look at the debates and experience the talk about the economy, we can do our best to transform what that means. For one thing, at a big level, the national system of accounts, which is, you know, the measure, I mean, it turns out that accounting systems decide what's valuable and then measure it, and if they don't decide it's valuable, they don't measure it, okay? So a third of the productive work in this country, which is caregiving, whether taking care of children or relatives or patients whatever it is, caregiving, which is still done mostly by women, but many men are doing it too, and whether it's done by women or men, it has an economic value. It's a third of the productive work in the whole country. It has no economic value whatsoever. None, zip, it's not counted, it's invisible, which is bad for economic planning. Now, a very smart woman named Teresa Funicello, who was on welfare herself, became a welfare warrior, became an economic theorist, you know, knows everything from here to there, figured out that you could easily attribute an economic value to caregiving at replacement level, how much would it cost to replace this function, and make that amount of money tax deductible if you pay taxes, and if people are too poor to pay taxes, if they're Romney's 42%, you know, that he doesn't care about, it would be tax refundable and substitute for the disastrous system of welfare reform. It's not hard. You could do it with the tax code. Here's another thing that's not counted in the national system of accounts, the environment. No wonder corporations plunder and pollute and cut down trees and so on. A tree that's standing there giving you oxygen has value. But no, it appears nowhere economically. It only becomes profitable after you cut it down. So no wonder, I mean, there's nothing on the debit side of the ledger, right? So at every level, whether it's that mega level or it's our electoral discussion level, there is no way in which equality and justice does not transform every single economic issue. I was thinking the other day about the death penalty, which as you know, we are the last advanced democracy to have in the world. And there are many, many, I'm sure many people in this room who are fighting against the death penalty. And then I thought, but interestingly, that's gender divided too. Because what is perceived as the death penalty is what is imposed by the state, and mostly on men, although some women suffer it too, but mostly on men. But what about all the deaths by stoning of women who have disobeyed their families or their husbands? What about all the bride burnings? What about, and some of them happen in this country, incidentally. There are, for instance, thousands of cases of female genital mutilation in this country, as we know. What, you're just as dead. Is that not the death penalty? But once we divide things into masculine or feminine, we divide our forces. It seems to me we could be working together against the death penalty altogether and simply saying the state cannot be a murderer, and if the state doesn't outlaw all forms of killing, then the state is a murderer too. The means are the ends. You can't, as we said in the Vietnam days, you can't destroy the village for peace. You can't kill for peace. The means become the ends. On campuses too, sometimes people will say to me, why is it that the same groups are against both lesbians and birth control? You know, that seems odd, right? But what they're not seeing are the connections, because the people who have been born into, through no fault of theirs, a hierarchical system and believe that sexuality is only moral and okay if it is directed towards having children inside patriarchal marriage. I mean, they believe that very strongly. So naturally, they are against both birth control and lesbians and gay men, so because this is sexual expression that cannot end in conception. It is 100% connected, and they know it's connected, I fear, better than sometimes we know it's connected. So that our movements really act in concert. The same thing is true. People will say to me, why are the same groups against safe and legal abortion and against immigration? Well, because their worry is the same thing. You know, in about 20 minutes, this country is no longer going to be a majority European-American country, which it seems to me perfectly logical, since Europe is no way the majority of the world. You know, I mean, it seems like it's a good thing that we're going to reflect most of the majority of the world. And it happens that by and large, although there are of course exceptions, by and large, white women tend to have fewer children than women of color. That's a terrible generalization, but that's what they're thinking, you know. And they're concerned about this country remaining a majority white country. You know, they apparently hasn't dawned on them, we all came from Africa. We did, I mean, we all came, you know. Some of us just went to cold places and lost our melanin and, you know, so lost our tribe and so on, but actually we all came from Africa. So they are worried about immigration because they see that as a source of people of color, and they're worried about especially worried about family planning, contraception and abortion because of its usage. It makes sense, but do we understand it? Do we understand it? Now we come to the question of religion, all right, which I think has become sort of politics you can't criticize. I hear quiet there. I think spirituality, to me, is often quite different from organized religion. And I mean, I know, I salute, I applaud everybody inside the great religions of the world trying to transform from within. That's great. I mean, we have to be everywhere, absolutely everywhere. But the even as a child, I wondered how come Jesus was blonde and blue-eyed in the middle of the Middle East. And if God is man is God, you know, we have to be able to say this, you know. I once long ago made the trip, which perhaps some of you have as well, on the Nile from the oldest Nubian parts of the Nile toward Cairo. And there you can actually physically see it. You know, you're in a houseboat gliding along and you get off and you see the carvings and the ruins. And in the oldest part, you see that God is presented as everything, as butterflies and papyrus and flowers and men and women and snakes and everything, everything. Then you get back in the boat, you go another couple of hours, it's 1,000 years later, suddenly there's not so much nature, and the goddess only has a son, no daughter. The plot thins, right? Okay. Then you go another hour or two, and it's another 1,000 years, and the sun has become a consort, taller than the goddess. Then you get to the beginning of the pharaohs, and the goddess has become the throne on which the pharaoh sits. And then you get to the most recent religion, which Islam, mosques, in which no representation of females or nature are allowed, right? And at the same time that I was making this trip, I was reading an Egyptologist who of the 1800s who just said flat out that monotheism is but imperialism in religion. I thought, yes, that's absolutely true. You know? Then I started to read about religious architecture, which I'm reminded of because of, right, okay. and there's a church, an architectural historian cheerfully saying, actually you can find some of this on the web now, that of course, obviously, most monotheistic religious structures, or many, are built to resemble the body of a woman because the central ceremony in which takes place in these buildings, in these rooms, is one in which men, the priesthood, take over the power of giving birth. The first task is to control women and control their bodies as the means of reproduction, but still, giving birth is like a big thing. You know, I mean, Freud and his penis envy just was nowhere compared to giving birth. Right. So he is pointing out, you know, as if I should have known this, that most religious structures tend to have an outer entrance and inner entrance, labia majora, labia minora, vestibula, it's actually the same word biologically and architecturally, in between, a vaginal aisle up the center, two curved ovarian structures on either side, and the womb in the center, where the miracle takes place, where men dressed in skirts, I said that, he didn't. But he didn't say that, but I think it's relevant. Anyway, say, true, you were born of woman, an inferior creature, so you were born in sin. But if you obey the rules of the patriarchy, you can be reborn through the priesthood, through men, through monotheism. And we will sprinkle imitation birth fluid over your head and give you a new name. And we can go women one better. This is what's interesting. We can give you everlasting life. Now, it turns out that the whole idea of elaborate heavens and everlasting life really came along gradually. None of this happens overnight, but gradually came along with patriarchy. Older cultures say you're joining your ancestors, you're going to the other side of the mountain. You know, there's all kinds of beautiful imagery, but it's not a carefully worked out system of heaven and hell and reward and punishment and so on. That was invented to go us one better, really. You know, to say, okay, yes, women can give you life, but we can give you everlasting life. And if you don't obey the patriarchy, look what will happen to you. You'll burn in hell and so on. I mean, and we fell for this? I mean, so, you know, of course we did, because if we're raised in it, you know, it feels like home. It's not a fault, it's just what happens. So I think that inside the great traditions and in various kinds of spiritualities, you know, I don't know that I'll live long enough to see a single pagan woman of color in the White House, but who knows? I think if you pull on any one of these threads, the whole it starts to unravel. It just starts to unravel, because we begin to see that we are linked, in fact, and not ranked. And one of the things that helped me, and incidentally, while I'm still talking about the Nile, that has to do not just with dominating females, but dominating nature. The whole idea that it is man's prerogative to dominate nature, that he is superior to that kind of hierarchy, really was not the iconography or the belief or the spirituality of the original cultures, of the Kwe and the San in Africa, of the Dalits in India, of our own Indian country here, of 600 nations. And now this is something that really troubles me as I travel around more and more over the years. I knew nothing about the history of the land beneath my feet. Nothing, nothing. And only because of the many Native women in the women's movement and, you know, just the happenstance of life, I began to learn that on this subcontinent of ours, there was the first representative democracy, long-term big representative democracy in the world. It was called the Iroquois Confederacy of Six Nations. It was flourishing at a time when Europe had only kings and emperors and dictators. It was the model for our Constitution. I believe law schools now are actually admitting that the Iroquois Confederacy was the model for our Constitution. It was the model for the League of Nations and the UN. It was a very sophisticated, layered system of circles of consent and consensus and choosing leaders. I think maybe our Electoral College actually is a residue of this, because the idea was that you made decisions for now with an eye to seven generations forward. Can you imagine doing that? But knowing that you wouldn't know all the conditions in the future, you elected wise people to make those decisions in the future. It isn't happening with our Electoral College, but I think maybe that's where it came from. Yet we still, if you look at the architecture in Washington alone, you would believe that democracy came from Greece. Greece had slavery. Greece had no women as equal citizens. And yet we're made to believe that. So this kept deepening and deepening, and finally I realized that actually the suffrage movement and the Underground Railway really were inspired by the original native cultures here because of the status of women, because in the case of the women's movement, the women who were chattel possessions, owned 100%, could see women over there who were equal, were in leadership, were controlled agriculture, controlled their own fertility, and they bonded over childbirth, because women who were having European origin women having children were called by Native women those who die in childbirth, because they were astounded by the degree to which that happened, because of corsets, because of killing witches who were healers, so they didn't have the same, for all kinds of reasons that was happening. They bonded over childbirth, and Elizabeth Cady Stanton listened to the Native women and managed to have one of her, six or seven children? I can't remember, but anyway, by herself, actually, and feel fine and get up the next day. Not that I'm saying we all have to do that, but I mean, I thought, how come nobody told me about this? How come nobody told me that the Underground Railway really was mostly in Indian country because they controlled territory and because they didn't believe in race? I mean, they just believed in the way. If you follow the way of balance and circular, all of that connection to nature, you were okay. You may notice that Native groups are always adopting people, so it's not about how you got born. It's about how you live. So, there's much more there, but I just want to say it in case any of us, I don't know if there's anybody from Indian country in this room who can further enlighten us, but it'd be really interesting to know who lived on this land. I've begun to be fascinated with vertical history. It's so intimate. Who got up in the morning and looked at the same vista? Who touched the same igneous rocks? It's just so much more connected than the kind of paper horizontal history that seems so distant from us. Anyway, all of that was the source of the button I made, which now is floating around the world, I believe, that says, "The truth will set you free, but first it will piss you off." And finally, amazingly, we seem to discuss both domestic crimes and international institutionalized warfare without discussing gender. And that really makes no sense. I'm looking back at my 1970 graduation speech, I discovered that even though I knew nothing, it seemed to me, I had found a guy named Jeffrey Gorer who said that the single shared characteristic of cultures without institutionalized violence was that the gender roles are not polarized. People are not taught men are not taught to their endangerment and detriment, that they have to be conquering and controlling and even violent in order to be masculine. And women are not taught that they have to be subordinate and serving and childbearing and so on in order to be feminine. And so we knew that, but I noticed that just a couple of weeks ago, there came out a book by a wonderful scholar who does the most helpful great thing, which is to prove what we know. And her name is Valerie Hudson, and she has three scholarly co-authors. The book is called Sex and World Peace, and she has shown through, as she says, through conventional aggregate empirical testing, that the best predictor of a state's peacefulness is not its level of wealth or its level of democracy or whether it is Islamic or not. The very best predictor of a state's peacefulness is its level of violence against women. And how is this part of our foreign policy? No. It's not. And it is so clear that if we don't learn in the home that it's okay for one group to dominate the other, that aggression and control are natural, if we don't create these polarized masculine and feminine roles into which then comes race, first of all and foremost, and religion and class and justifying the subject and object kind of paradigm that has been dug in our brains by these roles, we don't think it's natural. Some of the things that happen to me that are the most heartening are just the most ordinary. It's little kids saying, it's not fair. You are not the boss of me. Where do they get that? In countries all over the world, people say, I think we know. We have some inner knowledge when we are born that we are, there's something in us that's the result of millennia upon millennia of environment and heredity combined in a way that could never have happened before and could never happen again. And each of us is both unique and a member of the community. It's the hierarchy we need to unlearn. And of course, the most frustrating of divisions, I thought, in the last presidential election was the idea that you should care about sex or race. Which one? You cannot have racism without sexism. You can't continue racial divisions without controlling women as the means of reproduction. Wherever there is racism, it's infinitely worse for women. And not only women of color, but white women who are restricted sexually, and women of color who are exploited sexually in order to continue these kind of racial divisions. So I hope that more and more we begin to see that that life, you know, God may be in the details, and I'm all for details, but the goddess is in connections. And I hope that we see it and pioneer it. We have just barely, I would say, begun to make visible what has been invisible, and now we can begin to make linked that which is really organically in a circle. Yes, we have been through dependence. Yes, we have been through independence, but now we can hope for interdependence. Thank you. Thank you.